We're supposed to live in, under a form of government based on representation.
As long as you're not hurting anybody else.
Land of the free.
That I earned with my own blood from the people that are supposed to care for us, the Veterans Affairs.
In the past, procuring medicine was a nightmare for me. It was, you never knew what you were getting. It was usually just garbage.
And there's an army of lawyers in this country who actually make their living off public defender work. A large majority of people who go to court on drug charges can't pay for their own legal defense, take away the war on drugs, and a lot of the indigent defendants aren't in court anymore and don't need public defenders.
I've seen it far too many times where plea bargain systems have worked like this. Taxation through citation is mine. And I made it up a long time ago because a long time ago I got sick and tired of the taxation that is being dished out by our patrol officers all across this country.
It's been here since plants inhabited the earth. Vicodin, that's human created, that's chemically created, that's not natural. Putting a pill in, you don't know what's in it. Here you can open up a jar, you can sniff it, you can smell it, you can touch it, you can look at it, you know exactly what you're getting.
My grandma and my uncle are judging me for it, and I mean, I have grandparents all over that have read it in the newspapers and plastering my face all over the news and, you know, making it seem like I'm just some kind of big old drug dealer, and I just like to sit in my house and chill and smoke pot.
My gun is a Glock Model 22. It's a 40 caliber, semi-automatic. Can you see it? I'll remove it from its holster. It normally doesn't leave.
Citizens should be able to own guns, without a doubt.
A citizen is a person with a gun. A peasant is a person without a gun.
The vote was 434 yeas to one nay.
The Second Amendment to the United States Constitution says, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. By the way, the phrase well-regulated does not mean under government control. At the time of its writing, it meant well-trained and with equipment in good condition. Supreme Court Justice Scalia clearly understood this when he recently wrote for the majority in Heller that the adjective well-regulated implies nothing more than the imposition of proper discipline and training.
To me, the Second Amendment means we always have an insurance policy. The Second Amendment is a guarantor of our right to say no.
And if you pick up any dictionary, the word no does not mean some or with the exception of or except as provided for by law. It means no. And any parent with kids knows that what part of no don't you understand? Apparently, there's a part of no that our government does not understand.
And I don't want any other American to ever be in that group. A gun to me means I'm a free American. I would like to ask every politician who supports gun control, just what part of the Second Amendment don't you understand? Just what part of infringed don't you understand? And why is it that you, along with your bed partners of the NEA, try to rewrite American history and force your beliefs down the throats of our school students and tell them that the Second Amendment did not bestow or protect an individual right to keep and bear arms?
Politicians want to whittle away at our Second Amendment in order to protect themselves so that when they begin to make policy that people would vociferously disagree with, there is no resistance. I believe it is so that when they finally attempt to put themselves in power indefinitely, no one has any way to stop them.
Thomas Jefferson wrote in the Declaration of Independence of the concept of inalienable rights to life, liberty, and property. How can you possibly defend your life, liberty, and property in today's age without a gun?
The Second Amendment does not grant rights. The Second Amendment merely guarantees a right that already exists.
The Second Amendment did not yet exist on April 19, 1775. But the patriots at Lexington and Concord knew they didn't need permission.
The federal government likes to quote the Supremacy Clause. Maybe they ought to read it, because the Supremacy Clause does not say that the federal government is supreme. Far from it. It says only those laws made in pursuance of the Constitution are supreme.
Article 1, Section 7 of the Wyoming State Constitution says that, quote, absolute, arbitrary power over the lives, liberty, and property of free men exists nowhere in a republic, not even in the largest majority, unquote.
The people that we've elected into these offices to run this thing have, I think, turned our country into more of a police state than anything. We're, you know, a lot of people in this country worry about us heading towards socialism. I think we're closer to communism now. The way the laws are changing, they're heading that direction. And, you know, that's not what I served for.
The 10th Amendment to the United States Constitution says, the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively, or to the people.
What the federal government would have us ignore is that the 10th Amendment secures all rights not expressly granted to the federal government to the states and people at large. The federal government would have us forget that our Constitution expressly limits what they can do. Our Constitution tells the government what it is allowed to do. People who support one section of our Bill of Rights while ignoring the rest are hypocrites, because the Bill of Rights is not something that you can pick and choose from at will. Rights support each other. Our right to free speech allows us to protest when other rights are threatened. Our right to bear arms allows us physical defense of those rights. Our right to trial by jury allows us to be heard by our peers rather than silenced by a government.
It was before all the Amendment 20.
Our justice system has been replaced with a system of numbers. And
there are no good cops. There are good peace officers. There are men and women who honestly understand self-ownership and honestly understand the necessity for people to be responsible for themselves. Unfortunately, they are few and far between. The rest of them are...
We are spinning our wheels, wasting our time, wasting our money, and creating another branch of Big Brother government. I'm fed up with it. It's doing no good.
The only role of government is to coordinate those rules that people agree to and wish to live by.
I mean, the number one mistake people make maybe once in their lives, at least when trying to buy marijuana, is I gave my money to the dealer or whoever the guy was, and he said he would be right back, and he never came back.
We've been fighting this drug war for 40 years. We spend $70 billion a year, and what have we done? Drugs are more prevalent, they're more potent, and the rate of abuse is just as high as it ever was.
Depending on the legislation, of course, we're hoping that it becomes kind of a free enterprise, if you will. Anyone can join, anyone can open up a center, anyone that can do it better. Competition the American way is a beautiful thing.
It doesn't bother me, and I...
Yeah. And we both vote.
I feel there definitely is still lots of people that are against it, but here in Colorado at least, there's so many patients every day getting their medical marijuana cards, so many patients turning away from prescription pills and whatnot. It's kind of a growing surge. Activism's huge.
That's what America does for you.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that when the cartridge box is no longer available, the ballot box has very little meaning.
They've got some habits that need addressing.
Okay, there are definitely difference between a good cop and a bad cop. To me, the old Andy Griffith was the typical good cop. He was a peace officer. Nowadays, too often, we have law enforcement officers who are only concerned with enforcing the law as it is on the books, regardless of what makes sense or any common judgment regarding the situation. Most cops are good. Most cops are my friend. There are a few bad ones.
Taxes were unconstitutionally used to outlaw marijuana and enact forms of gun control because the people who wanted to achieve this knew that they did not have a constitutional route for doing so. They came up with the idea that there are just certain things in society that are too important for the Constitution to get in the way. So what they did was they said that you can have your marijuana, you can have your firearms, but they're taxed, and you have to have this stamp proving that you've paid the tax. And then they conveniently issued no stamps. It would be synonymous today with state legislatures saying that you can possess cigarettes if they have the little stamp that's on the bottom of every pack that they have today, but then they conveniently get rid of the stamps that prove that the tax was paid.
That's a tax on the people. It is ridiculous. It's a violation of the Eighth Amendment. And you, sir, you, Mr. Peace Officer, you swore an oath to uphold and defend the United States Constitution. Yet you think you can violate that Constitution without any repercussion and yet issue these tickets all day long to people who haven't done anything close to what you have done in violating your oath. That's perjury.
How can you tell a good law from a bad law? Since laws dictate action and are backed by action, it's the same as telling a good act from a bad act.
When you take guns out of the hands of honest, good, upstanding citizens, then the only people who have the potential to commit violence are criminals. Therefore, they have a monopoly on that, unless you're willing to sit around and wait and hope that the police show up in a timely manner to stop them.
Most of the bad peace officers don't call themselves peace officers. They call themselves officers of the state, or in other words, they're part of the police state. And they think that their job is to write as many tickets as they can, to make as many arrests as they can. And a true peace officer is there to protect people, not just make arrests.
There should be no distinction between government men and citizens. If we're all equal, then we should all have equal access to protection.
If we're going to get our country back, if we're going to get American constitutional liberty back, the states, the counties and cities, working with their people, again, remembering that we the people are the power source in this country for all political power. George Mason said that the militia was the people. So the reference to the militia in the Second Amendment is just talking about the people, because the people are the militia. And George Mason also said that to disarm the people is the best and most effectual way to enslave them. And so those of you who would enslave us in this country, Charles Schumer and Dianne Feinstein and Harry Reid and Nancy Pelosi and Barack Obama and all of the czars in his administration, I challenge you to, for once in your careers and life, support American idealism and support what America was based on. You are leading us away from American ideals. I sued the Clinton administration and lived to tell about it. One thing that it says in there is that the states and the counties and the political subdivisions of the state are just as supreme as the federal government. And who said that? The United States Supreme Court. And if you look at the strength and the power of the 10th Amendment and state sovereignty, it was never intended by our Constitution to create another tyrannical government worse than the one that we separated from in the Revolutionary War. And so, no, the states did not create the federal government to be our master or our supreme being. They can quote that supremacy clause all they want. It'd be nice if they quote it instead of just saying that it gives them supreme power, because it doesn't appear that any of them have ever read it. But they never read any of the other laws that they pass and shove down our throats. It just is another sign of the corruption in Washington, D.C.
Wyoming State Senator Cale Case put it well. He said, "I don't like being exposed to Kenny G's music, cigarette smoke, or patchouli oil, but I will defend the right of other folks to have all that junk, the right of business owners to allow it, and my right not to have to be around it. Government should not regulate anything that citizens can avoid by turning around and walking out."
We need our freedom. This country was built on freedom. Mm-hmm. That every citizen of this country has the right to prosper as long as it is not affecting anything or anyone negatively. Mm-hmm.
The Bill of Rights is not a Chinese takeout menu where we can have one from column A, one from column B, and eliminate column C. We cannot allow anyone to pick or choose our rights for us. The Bill of Rights is one single declaration with 10 sections. The Bill of Rights and...
In 2011, medical marijuana is legal in 16 states and the District of Columbia. Yet pot is still illegal at the federal level. Medical marijuana dispensaries were routinely raided and closed by feds with guns drawn during George Bush's administration, and Barack Obama has continued this. Obama campaigned on a promise to stop this practice, but jackbooted thugs are still raiding marijuana health centers, ignoring the state's rights guaranteed under the 10th Amendment. Feds are also trampling states' rights with regard to guns. Alaska, Montana, Idaho, Wyoming, Utah, Arizona, Tennessee, and South Dakota have passed Firearms Freedom Acts, which declare the right to manufacture firearms and ammunition for use and sale only within that particular state without federal interference or regulation. The Wyoming law even allows for the arrest and prosecution of federal agents violating that law. In response to this legislation, the feds have sent warnings to gun sellers in these states, threatening their licenses to sell in other states, in essence, threatening their very livelihoods. The feds refuse to recognize the states' rights to pass these laws, claiming the Commerce Clause in the Constitution prohibits this. This is a gross misappropriation of the intent of the Commerce Clause, which was intended to encourage commerce between the states, not give the feds ultimate control over all commerce. 22 other states have introduced firearms freedom legislation. Many U.S. states recognize concealed carry weapons permits from other states, but only 3 states, Montana, Michigan, and Rhode Island, recognize medical marijuana permits from other states. So if a patient drives from Colorado to Montana, she would not legally be permitted to possess her medicine while passing through Wyoming. If she travels a lot for business, she'd either have to go without medical marijuana for extended periods of time, or put herself in constant risk by attempting to take her medicine with her. In Alaska, Arizona, Vermont, and Wyoming, a permit is not required to carry a concealed gun. However, Alaska, Arizona, and Wyoming still issue permits for people who want them, because they are valid in some other states. In Wyoming, Colorado, Arizona, Montana, and 34 other states, concealed carry gun permits are shall issue. Any mentally sound, non-felon adult can get one, yet a small amount of marijuana is a serious crime in some of these states, and most have no provision for medical marijuana, even if you're dying a painful death of cancer. These government permission slips for guns and pot also cost money. This randomly applied tax violates several sections of the Constitution. A concealed carry permit is nearly impossible to get in Los Angeles or San Francisco, unless you're a judge or a movie star. Yet there, medical marijuana cards are practically shall issue. Just about any adult who wants one can get one. But possession of a gun in public without a permit is a serious felony. You can walk around Wyoming with a loaded gun on your hip without a permit, but they'll throw you in prison for a year or more for a few grams of pot. In California, possession of a small amount of pot is a misdemeanor, or even the equivalent of a simple traffic ticket. In November 2010, a ballot initiative to legalize all pot possession for personal use failed in California. The vote was 53.9% against. Before the vote, Los Angeles County Sheriff Lee Baca said he'd continue to bust people for marijuana possession, even if pot had become legal at the state level. Obama-appointed Attorney General Eric Holder had the same plan, acting under pressure from the President of Mexico.
Cartoons for Tampa.
But if you walk around San Francisco or Los Angeles with a gun on your hip, you'd likely end up with cops or even SWAT throwing you to the ground, putting a gun to your head, and taking you to prison. These issues are further confused by the fact that private firearm ownership is legal nationwide. The right to keep and bear arms is clearly protected by the Second Amendment. While we believe that freedom of ingestion is a basic human right, at this time it is not clearly stated in the law. The overreach of the feds is invasive, harmful, and applied in a seemingly random way. The capriciousness of various states in allowing or denying firearm freedoms is confusing and puts good folks at risk. Furthermore, None of this protects anyone from anything and only ruins the lives of honest people. The feds seem to resent the Constitution, feel it gets in their way. Their continued failure to recognize individual freedoms will turn our country into a bleak and unlivable police state. And all states need to recognize their citizens' natural rights if America is to keep from sliding into a totalitarian hell.